Time really means modification. Hi, this is Clarity Ross for the Christ Clarity Channel. And we just do a real quick, simple video here because we're focusing in on stepping out of time, which is the remedy that I'm prescribing to cure what ails us. Stepping out of time means experiencing non-modification. Experiencing time means experiencing modification. Modification means change. Non-modification means no change is taking place. If there's no change taking place, how could there be time? What meaning? It'd be meaningless, wouldn't it? 1 year, a trillion years, no change. No change ever. Why even talk about time? It's meaningless. Whereas when modification is taking place, we speak, superimpose a time system on that and talk about it as the modification that took place in the past and the modifications that we foresee taking place in the future. We call that time. There really isn't anything per se called time. It's just it's our way of keeping track and referring to this ceaseless play of modification, which is really a dream. It's really an imagining of spirit. It's an imagining of mind in the service of spirit. It's an imagining that enables spirit to forget what it really is. And so, for spirit to remember what it really is, spirit has to step out of time, step out of modification, stop experiencing modification, and experience non-modification. Now we know, either through remembrance or through other means of testimony from people, that after the body dies, experiencing continues on in the afterlife. And in the afterlife, there's also constant modification. So death is not stepping out of time at all. Okay, even though many think that's it. It's very, very crucial to hear that death is not it. Absolutely is not it. The ego tells you that when you die, that's it. You step out of time, no more modification, you're free. That's a lie. Okay, because what happens after death, you continue on experiencing all sorts of modifications. They're just not the modifications that we see here in the world. There are other modifications, afterlife modifications. And eventually you just continue on cycling through all sorts of modifications, call them dimensions, call it whatever you want. It's all the same. It's modification. What you are, what we are, spirit cannot be modified. So there's no way that spirit can know what it is by constantly experiencing modification. It's not possible. It causes the spirit to be in a state of deep forgetfulness. Spirit to remember what spirit is. Spirit needs to experience non-modification. Now, where can that be found? That is the whole point of these videos, by choosing a new idea. And a new idea, non-modification is the effect of choosing a new idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator. Spirit wanted to be prime creator, chose the idea, had to forget, therefore it had to forget what it is, because it's prime created. So mind presented this vast scenario of modification we call the play of consciousness, the Mahamaya, the divine dream. Play of modification, the evolution of consciousness, etc. It's all a play of modification to distract us from what we are, from remembering what we are. We talk about the evolution of consciousness as if it's something spiritual. It's not. It's just this vast, slow-moving scenario of forgetting what we are. As we look at this, we're just dragged through endless forgetting modifications. Modification after modification after modification after modification, on and on and on and on and on. Until we catch wind of what we really are, and we say, wait a minute, what I am cannot be modified. I'm the non-modifiable. The allegories are used like, it's not an allegory, that's a, for instance, space, you know, pure space would be a symbol of what we are. A metaphor. Okay, metaphors are used like space, pure space. Everything appears in pure space. All the modifications appear, but pure space is not being modified at all. It remains exactly the same as it always has been. That's a metaphor for what we are. So as long as our attention is on the modifications, we won't realize what we are. But if we turn our attention to the pure space, as it were, then we remember what we are. This pure space is a metaphor for the effect of choosing a new idea, the idea of not wanting to be prime creator. That gives rise to an overlay effect. An effect that is not being modified. Okay. So when we experience the effect of non-modification, an effect that's not being modified, we're stepping out of time. We're stepping out of time, just like that. And as we abide in that experiencing of that which is not modifiable, we're remembering what we are. Automatically we remember what we are, and we say, ah, all of this modification was just a vast con game that we were playing with ourselves so that we could pretend that we were prime creator. That's all it is. No significance to it. No outcome to it. It's just necessary so we can pretend to be prime creator. That's all it is. The entire play of the cosmos is only necessary so that we can pretend to be prime creator. All this modification. Why do we need so much modification? Because it's very difficult for us to be forgetful of what we are. Very difficult. We need an enormous structure and design to induce this forgetfulness. We look at the universe and say there's all sorts of design and structure, etc. Of course, there needs to be in order to induce this forgetfulness. Because forgetting what we are is not something natural to us at all. Something completely unnatural. So there has to be a very confusing, very complex, very compelling, very plausible scenario fashioned so that we can look at it and say, is this what I am? And we keep puzzling over it. And in the puzzling of it, over it, we forget what we are. We're in a state of forgetfulness of what we are. Awful situation. But there's no purpose, no meaning, no outcome, etc. to existence at all. There's no outcome to it. It's only there to enable us to pretend that we're prime creator. To pretend meaning it's plausible to us. Okay, that's what pretend means. That we're in this condition of believing that it's plausible, that we could be prime creator. Reality is not reciprocal at all. Reality goes from the prime creator to the prime created. In other words, the prime creator created the prime created spirit, but spirit did not create the prime created. Okay? It's not reciprocal at all. So we cannot be prime creator, but we can make it seem plausible. The mind can give us this play of plausibility, as I call existence, the play of plausibility. And as long as we're paying attention to that, we feel as if we could be prime creator. That is what we get. That is the drug, the addiction of existence. We feel as if we could be prime creator. It's possible. It's plausible. And therefore, that is our pretending. We can kind of feel like we're trying it on for size. You know, we're sizing it up, getting a feel for it. That's what in existence, that's what we believe. We believe we're getting a feel for being prime creator. That's all that it is. But existence itself, the structure and design of existence is only for this purpose, to give us this plausible feel that we're getting into being prime creator. Without that purpose, without their existence, is nothing. No use for it. We drop it, throw it in the trash bin. Has no interest, no attraction to us. None. And as we go closer and closer to choosing a new idea, one will find that existence loses its appeal. I can directly testify to this. As I look at all the stuff that people are really into, that they're enthralled by, to me it holds no attraction whatsoever. There's nothing, zero. And I scratch my head and say, what in the world do people find attractive in all of this? Again, it's not the thing in itself that's attractive. It's that it enables forgetfulness of what we are, so we can then have this plausible feeling that we could be prime creator, and that something that we're interested in. Like, wow, so this is what it's like to be prime creator. You know, that's the kind of the feeling we're all kind of in on this, kind of an inner knowing, so to speak, in existence. Like everyone's kind of in on the conspiracy, in on this con, you know, that we're all getting it. We're not getting anything. We're just getting pretend, as if plausibility, not actuality. But again, the staging is nothing to us, really. It's just an enabler. That's all it is. And when one gets tired of this plausibility con, self-deceit, this forgetfulness, then existence just loses its pull, loses its attractiveness. And if we don't understand what's happening, we might think we're getting depressed, or say we're really depressed, there's nothing as interesting anymore. That's true. You look at the movies, and I was just watching a video, had all these scenes from movies, and I just couldn't believe it. I just said, you know, none of those just has zero compelling interest at all. Whereas I know, you know, 50 years ago, people watching those movies, and they were just like so incredibly amazing, because we're in a state of deep forgetfulness of what we are. And here we're watching these movies, and to us, it's like we're in this great pretense, and we're seeing so much meaning in it, so much emotion, so much drama. All of that emotion and drama is simply the plausible belief that we could be prime creator. You know, it causes us to be fascinated. But once this fascination is gone, existence is very, very flat. I can tell you that. That's why they call, in depression, they say everything seems flat. Depression is just your desire to choose a new idea manifesting itself and not being recognized yet. Once you recognize it and say, whoa, wait a minute, this isn't a bad thing, this is a great thing. I'm really getting very close to choosing a new idea and being freed from this horrible, horrible misery and suffering of existence. Then the depression, one doesn't see it that way. It's seen as opportunity. And if you're around a lot of people who see you're fascinated by the world, then you feel like ostracized. And then that's the part that really brings the suffering to depression. Whereas if you feel that there are many others who see the same way, everything's very flat, very unfascinating, and they're not interested in increasing their fascination with the world, want to drop it, then one feels that this is a positive, very positive situation. And there's no reason to feel ostracized or weird or anything like that. But in a society that like we have now, which is in hell-bent on trying to invest in fascination, people are depressed and they go to the doctors, they hear, take these antidepressants. They don't give any depth of understanding of what's really going on at all. That's an unbelievable shame, unbelievable ignorance. Because really, the loss of fascination with the world, where everything looks flat, uninteresting, is really a very high spiritual condition. It's a very advanced condition. It means that you're getting closer to choosing a new idea. You're getting closer to stepping out of time. That is a fact. The consideration is there. Whereas those who are fascinated with the world, they never even think about stepping out of time. For them, that would be crazy. Because they're having this dream of being prime creator. Why would they want to stop that? You know? So it never occurs to step out of time. But here, you know, there's support for that. Experiencing non-modification, like some of the great touchstones in history, Ramana Maharshi. What was he doing? He was experiencing non-modification. He was abiding in this steady bliss, a steady state, a steady condition. Peace beyond understanding. Getting a pure reflection of what he really is, spirit. That which is created by God. Extension of the mind of God, extension of God. So we can do that. And in some cultures, you know, that's the goal. In some places and times in history, that's been the goal. So there wasn't depression during those times. People didn't get depressed because it was a cherished and honored goal to get to this flattening, and you know, people then would honor that and say, come on, you know, you're really advanced, keep going, just go all the way. So it seemed like a very, very positive thing. There's also a stress-based depression of just too much stress. It really is just exhaustion. But I'm talking about the type of depression where everything just seems dull, uninteresting, flat, boring, etc. And that's the emergence of this desire to choose a new idea, to drop the world. Because the fascination is gone, the spell is gone, the thrill is gone. And if it's not seen properly in a society that doesn't value and honor that, then one will desperately try to chase after thrills, you know, cheap thrills, try to put the thrill back into life, whatever kind of thrill they can find. And then they, you know, that gets labeled, the person gets labeled negatively from that too. So it's a vicious circle. Instead of that, people should honor this ability to drop the fascination and step out of time, experience the non-modifiable effect, that which is not being modified. The nirvana, that's called stepping into nirvana. Nirvana means not moving, meaning non-modification. In times and various times and places, that's been held up as the goal, the most responsible goal, honored goal, attain nirvana. And in such societies, increasing the fascination of existence, it was not a goal, was not an objective, was not supported. So maybe those cultures seem rather dull. Yeah, but it's a dullness, a profound dullness, because it's a turning towards stepping out of time and remembering what we really are. Whereas right now in this razzle-dazzle, Vegas-style world we live in, we, you know, value fascination with the world. And we value those who bring us that fascination. We value those who respond to this fascination. And we completely forget about those who see everything as boring and uninteresting and flat, who've dropped the fascination with it. They don't even register. They're non-entities here. It's unbelievable how this world has fallen so far. It's unbelievable unless you bring in certain factors into play. And then it becomes more believable. I think a lot of people are puzzled, kind of saying, what's happened to this world? You know, and just kind of, but if you know the larger cosmic picture, then it's not so puzzling. Some say we're in a Kali Yuga, meaning a dark age. We certainly are. Dark age meaning tremendous fascination with the world, all the glitz and the glitter. Every movie trailer you see, it's darker and darker, more and more frantic viciousness. Why? To keep us fascinated. So we can keep pretending that we can be prime creator. That's it. That's all it is. This world is being driven now by those who are experts at fascination. So that is why we have fallen so far. We've gotten a big push. Gotten a big push to fall. Push is not only coming from this planet, it's coming from other planets, other entities in the cosmos who want to use this planet as a place of fascination. They see it as fabulously set up for that purpose. And they have conformed this planet and the society and the world culture towards fascination. And they're using it to remain deeply fascinated with existence. And they're pushing it further and further and further in that direction. So for those who don't want to be fascinated, they have zero value in the world right now. They're invisible, non-entities. And if they want to stay in this world, they'll be given a job picking up trash. That's how much the ego values them. Because they're not helping out with fascination. They're not playing the game of plausibility anymore. So they're seen as useless in this type of world, where this world is like being conformed into a resort of fascination. Fascination resort, planet Earth. It's literally being turned into that, developed into that. It's like a developer came to this planet and said, this is a great development opportunity. Okay, let's do a tear down, let's remodel. I see this, there's this land and all this opportunity here, and I have a vision for it. So employ eminent domain, as it were, and say, okay, this, all this stuff is in the way. Let's tear it all down. Let's rebuild. Let's remodel. Let's turn it into this very fascinating place. And let's get rid of all these, anything that has to do with non-fascination. Let's just get rid of it. Either ignore it, undermine it, ridicule it. Get rid of it so this planet can be a resort of fascination. And that's what's happened. So it's not puzzling. Not puzzling at all. We see how developers work. Developers go to an area and they see, you know what? I see this in a different way. Let's bring the bulldozers in. Let's change it. Let's build something here. Let's develop this. Los Angeles, for instance, you know, 100 plus years ago, it was just a desert, a barren wasteland. But you had developers come in and they said, you know what? We want to build a paradise here. And that's what they set out doing. They got some water from the Owens Valley and began selling real estate And then they brought in the Merchants of Fascination, Hollywood, set up shop there, and it became the center of world fascination. So developers see an opportunity to use something in a way they want to use it, and then they go about transforming it to that for that purpose. So this world has been developed. This development of this world has taken place by off-world entities. Some people call them various names. Reptilians is one name that's been used. There's various entities involved, but basically their purpose is to conform, develop this world into a resort that will maintain a deep fascination in existence for them, so that they can continue to pretend to be Prime Creator. Very simple. So for those who have no interest in this, they are expendable completely. They seem to have no value here. They are the lowest, the Sudrak class, the lowest of the low, given the lowest tasks, given no place in society. And are told that they're depressed, something wrong with them. Now, can this be turned around right now? No, I don't think so. The confirmation of this planet to a place of extreme fascination has already taken place. And now we're in a phase where destructivity is coming, and there's a great fascination with destructivity. Watching things be torn down is very fascinating for most. Watching modification at work. Why are we fascinated with that? Because it induces a very deep forgetfulness of what we are, which has the corollary to that is that we feel enhanced plausibility that we can be Prime Creator. It's like a drug. Destructivity is like a drug because it's very, very intense modification, quick, intense modification. It gives us this hit of forgetfulness so strong that the plausibility quotient rises up at that point. So there's so many on this planet right now whose purpose in being here is to receive that really strong hit of forgetfulness so that they can experience a new level of plausibility, so to speak. That's how they're seeing it. Plausibility is viewed in levels or degrees of intensity. And what they're seeking here, they know this world is going to go through catastrophes. That's why they're here. And it may seem strange. You think, why would entities incarnate on a planet if it was known that great catastrophes were going to take place here? And the answer is that that's exactly what they want. Because they feel that the level of forgetfulness will be greatly increased, which will then lead to a great increase in the feeling of plausibility that they're Prime Creator. And they're very eager to experience this. For them, destructivity is a very small price to pay. They don't care if they die. They don't care if everybody dies. It doesn't matter to them. In fact, everybody collectively, they want to die. It's like a sacrificial planet. Collective sacrifice, because they feel through that dying, through that vast, intense modification, that'll bring such a deep forgetfulness of what they really are, that they can then have a much stronger pretense of being Prime Creator. It'll give them an amazing experience, they believe. That's what's believed. So that is really what's holding people to this planet, holding them in time, because modification takes place in time. That's what's keeping us from stepping out of time, experiencing non-modification, because we feel like we're going to miss out on a new high watermark of plausibility. That we'll miss the getting drunk on the wine of plausibility. Which is true. But plausibility that we're Prime Creator doesn't help us remember what we really are. And it's a very unfulfilling state. It's temporary, very temporary. And it's amazing how the universe works like that. Very sacrificial. It has to be, because that we have to keep getting these hits of forgetfulness. You know, dying is a powerful agent of forgetfulness of what we are, which is why they say the reptilians practice sacrifice, human sacrifice, sacrifice of all types. That gives them a hit of a very strong hit of forgetfulness of what they are, which then boosts their feeling, a plausible feeling that they're prime creator. In other words, boosts their ego. They go on literally on an ego trip from sacrifice, human sacrifice. That's why the ancients practiced human sacrifice to the gods. The gods were the reptilians that had been here in the past. And they knew that the reptilians really, really love this. They're addicted to it. And they felt they could get the help from the reptilians to help out if they gave them these, you know, sacrifices, human sacrifices. Again, the dynamic is death brings a deep sense of forgetfulness of what one really is, because what one really is a spirit that can't die. It's immortal. It's eternal. Can never be harmed in any way. So as one is witnessing this severe harm to a body, one is in a state of extreme forgetfulness of what one really is. And that then enables one to fantasize, have a fantasy of being prime creator. An ego trip. So literally addicted to ego trips. These aspects of spirit that are still in deep delusion, deep forgetfulness of what they really are. And so they've conformed this world into such a place. And of course, when one watch movies with all this violence, same thing. One doesn't really, when one's kind of feels adverse to the violence, they use eroticism to sugarcoat it and pull one into this deep state of forgetfulness. These are the rituals and the magics and all those things of the ones who are still ego tripping. Ego tripping is very boring. It's very foolish, silly. When this world loses its fascination, then all of that seems just utterly flat and ridiculous. When one gets a taste of what one really is, then the taste of ego tripping is very, very dull, uninspiring, unattractive. And then one withdraws withdraws from fascination over existence, and all this stupid magic and rituals, etc., have no pull. But unfortunately, this planet, as foreseen long ago, would be conformed into such a place, a very wicked place. It is, this world right now is a very, very wicked place. You might say it's profoundly wicked, meaning it's heavily, heavily invested in fascination and destruction and ego tripping. The news constantly bringing us stories, gruesome stories. It's all that it does. Nonstop bombarded with that. We're bombarded, no matter what shows on television, we're bombarded with trailers from Hollywood movies that are just incredibly violent and vicious. I mean, they don't even bother to disguise it anymore. Kids shows, you know, got these trailers in them. Stuff that children are watching, baseball games, you know, sporting events, stuff that, you know, your 8-year-old could be watching has these incredibly violent. And of course, all the video games are unbelievably violent, horrible. Those are all designed by ego trippers, egotists, like ego trips. In other words, this, that hit of pretense that one could be prime creator. So this world has been flooded with ego trippers. Literally, like tourists. And this world has been turned into a tourist attraction for ego trippers. That is a fact. And those who don't like that, I say, you know, time to take flight. flight out of here. The world is not what it used to be at all. It didn't used to be this bad. It's been fundamentally redeveloped. Of course, the general parameters of everything being modified are still all there. Existence has always been a state of extreme forgetfulness, but it's possible to actually intensify it and go on these ego trips. The music is, you know, it's getting faster. Everything's getting faster. More and more modification. You know, throw a million notes into a song. People can't stand just the very smooth, slow, mellow, few notes, you know, simple music that sounds so beautiful, that has so much space in it. Not a lot going on. What does that do? That kind of eases up on the fascination of existence, doesn't it? Slows it down, and we start thinking a little bit about remembering what we are. Like a soft breeze. Just a gentle soft breeze, not really trying to do much, barely rustling the leaves. Right now we've got the world's like a violent tornado. You know, extreme modification. Extreme weather, so to speak, on all levels here of the planet. And that's by design. People, the ego trippers want to see the thunder and the lightning, you know. They want to see the robots tearing each other apart. They need it. They want that hit, that ego hit of feeling like it's plausible that they're prime creator. They're the king and they're queen of the universe, of reality. Not that the universe that we see is reality. But the idea is the same, the king or queen of the universe. So, those who don't want this, what to do? I always say, time to relocate. And where there's a will, there's a way. Go to a place that's not designed for ego tripping. This place here is so wired for it. Utterly wired for it. It's unbelievable what's taken place. And it's just, you know, scandalous. Horrible. And of course, those who are here, ego trippers, for them, they think it's great. They love it. This is fantastic. They call it progress. You know, they're frantically into building their little soundstage here. Where they can have all sorts of explosions. All sorts of bells and whistles. All sorts of destructivity. You know, I mean, in the movies they build all these sets, these very elaborate sets. Spend a lot of money and a lot of time and effort on these sets. Why? So they can blow them up and film it, and people go watch that and they say, wow, we love it. Why do people love all this violence in the movies? Helps them forget what they are. You know, like a blackout. Gives them almost a blackout. So they just have no, utterly, you know, almost utterly forgetful of what they are. Temporarily, this is just extreme amnesia of what they are. And then that enables them to fantasize, give a stronger fantasy that they could, that they're prime creator. That's why I go to the movies. I won't even go to the movies. I don't watch movies. I watch maybe a little golf on television, but even then the commercials can be very nasty. It's getting to the point, it's getting so intrusive here, that's so blatant and aggressive and intrusive. The entire structure of fascination with the world, with forgetfulness of what we are, and the ego tripping that brings about is so aggressive and unrepentant here. That it's just appalling. No shame. No shame. The ego trippers have no shame. They have no sense that this is something very deplorable that they're doing. because it is enmeshing them and the planet into enormous delay, enormous misery and suffering. Because these deep habits don't let go easily. The more attention one pays to being fascinated by all this, the deeper the forgetfulness goes, the more delay there is, the tougher it is to get out of this, this tornado. Huge sacrifices, planetary sacrifices, do take place. They're set up, and so many flock to the situation like spectators to an event, and there's like going to the Colosseum in ancient Rome to watch the gladiators. The stands are packed right now. 7 billion people are packed onto this planet because there's going to be catastrophe here. And they want to experience it because they feel that will elevate their feeling of being prime creator to a new heights. And this is like an enormous opportunity for them. They call it an expansion of consciousness, a growth in consciousness, whatever. You can spiritualize it with spiritual terms, but it's exactly the same as ego tripping. The idea that somehow sacrifice has anything to do with reality is just insanity. Nothing is sacrificed in reality. Nothing can ever be touched or harmed or lost or modified in any way. How can we remember this fact when our attention is on modification? It's not possible. Not possible. All we get is ego tripping here. When one's attention is on time, all we get is ego tripping. That's it. In this place, we have to admit we came in here, most of us, for some ego tripping. Maybe with great reservations, but still. But we may have had enough of it, and now we're looking at the planet and we say, my gosh, it's just, ego tripping on steroids here. The whole planet's on steroids, literally. I mean, everybody's taking medications. Steroids, medications, all sorts of thrills. It's just amped up, very, very amped up. The music got really amped up in the 60s, didn't it? Everything got really amped up. Before, the style was very romantic, which is another way of deep forgetfulness, highlighting the special relationship and feeling very romantic about it and heartbreak and all this. And that too gets us, the loss of love, it brings us into a state of, deep forgetfulness of what we are. And then we can ego trip off of that, believe that we're prime creator. Different style, but the style now is much, much more intense and aggressive. And some of us even long for the good old days where it wasn't that way. But it was still bad then. It was still very bad. There's never a time on this planet where it's not very bad. It's just that right now, it's extremely bad. Which is getting a lot of us to think, wait a minute, this is not what I bargained for here. I didn't come here for this. And those who have foresight, they were able to see what's been taking place here. They knew it was going to happen, and then they've seen it. It's happened. It's literally happened. Just as foretold. This world has been redeveloped. Into a very gaudy, brassy, brazen situation of glitz and glitter and fascination and entrancement with the world. Very profound, sleep-inducing medicine here. Forgetfulness-inducing medicine is very powerful here now, and will become even more so soon, and culminated by catastrophes and massive sacrifice, loss of life on this planet, which again it feeds this great desire to feel what it's like to be prime creator. That's how the existence generates this plausible feeling is through sacrifice. I call the universe a vast sacrificial machine. And sometimes it's more intense than others, which is why, again, there's 7 billion people here chomping at the bit in this pack in the stands, waiting for the show to take place. And a lot of them are want it to get going right now, you know, and it will. It will get going very soon. Which is why those who want to take flight will take flight very soon. In other words, relocate. Not interested in sacrifice at all. It's flat. Has no interest. It's amazing. You see people go to the movies and the stuff that they watch and they're fascinated by it. Completely drawn into it. Whereas you might feel completely repulsed by it. Just you realize the price you pay as you go ego tripping, which is so unstable, so miserable. It's such a fearful condition, ego tripping. It's a short high and then a fearsome price that you pay for ego tripping. And that's why the ego trippers, they keep trying to double up and get stronger and stronger, you know, hits of the narcotic of forgetfulness, which is why they demand more and more sacrifice, which is, again, I've said that the reptilians in history demanded, you know, human sacrifice from humans. Eventually, this was transferred into animal sacrifice, sacrifice of various things. The idea remained the same, that something is killed, modification takes place, extreme modification of material things, and that gave the ego trippers a quick hit of forgetfulness and plausibility of being prime creator, and they keep needing this, you know, because the ego hit doesn't last very long and has very bad side effects. And so they keep telling us, well, this final catastrophe, end of the world, will solve that problem once and for all. The forgetfulness of what we are will be so supreme, and that the ego hit, a plausibility that we're prime creator, will be so profound that we won't have any bad side effects anymore. That's the lie that's being told. As a matter of fact, it's the opposite. The side effects will be horrible. So it's important for there to be teachers around who have the clarity about all of this and can just say, okay, you know, this is what happened. This is what's going on. It's very simple. You have to calm down, but it may take a long while to calm down. That kind of high has such severe side effects. But the remedy is a step at a time. Just simply experience that which cannot be modified, which means that you're remembering what you really are, which means you're giving up the fantasy of being prime creator. That's called repentance. That's called the gospel. That's called the good news. That's what called what responsibility. That's what you're called to is repentance. You're called to repentance, called to step out of time, which isn't difficult. Stepping out of time means stepping out of modification. Means you're not paying attention to modification. Means you're not experiencing modification. Like it's flat. It's so flat. It's like just a shadow. Vague shadow is all it is, really. No interest anymore. Whereas non-modification becomes the interest. Nirvana, samadhi, peace beyond understanding, the overlay, vision of oneness. That becomes very, very interesting, and the attention rests on that. So, we have several themes, stepping out of time and relocation. Those are reoccurring themes, because this planet here is slated for catastrophe. And again, the idea that, well, 7 billion people here, that couldn't possibly happen, is just the opposite. They're here exactly because they know it's coming, and they want it to come. They're eager for it to come. The idea that somehow this can be blocked or changed is nonsense, because the vast majority of the world want it to happen. because they feel it's going to give them a new heights of feeling as if they were prime creator. So they don't want to stop it. They might, throw a bunch of spiritual labels on it, which is what they do, ascension of some sort, shift in, dynamic shift in the global consciousness, all sorts of ways of sugarcoating it. But it's at its root, is all exactly the same desire for that hit, that super hit, that super ego trip. That's why they're here. And there's a few of us that don't want that, not interested in that. That's what Jesus said, that he's coming back for those people. Who's he coming back for? Those who are not interested in this ego trip. That's very simple. Very simple. That's it. That's all it is. If you're not interested in sacrifice, you're the one who will take flight, so to speak, relocate, give up your ego tripping. Because this world will go through what the blueprint is, what everyone wants to experience here. They want to see it all being torn down, because that brings about a profound forgetfulness of what one is. Because reality can never be torn down in any way. There's no tearing down whatsoever. So by seeing it, all this planet being torn down, torn to pieces, one is in a state of deep forgetfulness of what one really is, of what reality is, which opens the door to the plausible, the fantasy of being prime creator. But that door doesn't stay open very long, because the attraction back to reality is still there, very profound. And so new sacrifices are sought, and difficulties are encountered. So keep that in mind. And this video has gone on longer than I thought, because as soon as I open my mouth, all of this starts just pouring out that I didn't plan at all. It just comes from the intention to be of service and usefulness and help here, value. Just all it is that intention, and then from there, that intention just takes the form of words here for to be shared. So this is all a warning and a clarification. And remember that stepping out of time is very simple. It's merely choosing a new idea, which is called repentance, and experiencing the effect of that idea. And we have every right to do that, because trying to be prime creator, the prime creator didn't ask spirit to try and be prime creator, guaranteed. Believe that, because you know it's true. Prime creator didn't tell spirit that spirit had to have a reciprocal relationship, that prime creator creates spirit and then spirit has to create prime creator. That's insanity. That's insanity. There's no expansion there. There's no enrichment there. And it's not true. Prime creator did not create that way, did not ask spirit to try and be prime creator and create prime creator, did not do that. It's spirit that had the whim to do this. Okay, so we absolutely are within our rights to drop this nonsense, this ego tripping. And where do we go? Those who don't want to go ego tripping, where do they go? There's a place for them, place for that. There's a place for that. Absolutely have to have faith in that. There is a place for that. There's all sorts of different levels of ego tripping, depending on what it wants. Right now in this world, very severe ego tripping here. That's why the people who have come into this planet are very different than the people who were here previously. Very different. And it's amazing the experiences I've had with these people, because they're here for some hardcore ego tripping. And that's their focus. And they don't respect anything other than that. And they look at us milder ego trippers as fools, dilettantes, amateurs. Get out of the way. We'll show you how it's done. That kind of nonsense. As if we're idiots, fools, We don't know how to get it done. We don't know how to take a real ego trip. We got the heavyweights coming in now. The big production. Studio chiefs are coming in with the big time box office bonanza producers, who really know how to put on a show. They're all here now. They're all working on the movie now. And this us little folks, get out of the way. Oh yeah, we'll get out of the way, that's for sure. We'll go to a place where the ego tripping is not so severe. Maybe even none. There are places where there's none. I've seen such places. I've seen a place like just like that where it supports no ego tripping whatsoever. Nothing's being modified. And ultimately, we can choose to experience Nirvana right now, vision of oneness right now. But again, that won't stop the planet from going through all the stuff that the ego trippers want. All right, we can end this one up on 5555 again. It just seems to work out that way right now. And I'll do that. Very great. That's it for this video.